Mr. President, board, guests, high school students, I'm very pleased and honored to be here. I was introduced to some of the fine tradition of your past presidents, some of the very prestigious names that are on the cup up here. And tradition certainly is part of what the Navy is all about. For the high school students, it was always cool when I was a student if the teacher was going to show a video, because it meant we could, you know, go to sleep for a little bit. And I'm going to indulge you here with a 4-minute video on something called RIMPAC, which is the largest naval exercise that has ever occurred in the history of the world. There was more naval power brought together than has ever been assembled before. And your Royal Canadian Navy was a large part of it, and I could go on for an hour just about that, but pictures are worth 1,000 words, so a video must be worth millions of words. So we'll make sure we get this to work here.
Thank you.
Well, I must still love what I do because it gave me goosebumps watching that. So I don't know about you, Chief, but when I watch that, it makes me want to go back out there and do it again. A couple things you should know about that particular video. One is sailors, Naval Reservists that attend Fanshawe and the University of Western Ontario participated in that exercise. They were sailors at sea. And the commander who is in charge of conducting the battle, of fighting the fight in the exercise, was a Canadian Naval Reservist as well. Last thing that I'll point out in that video is the submarine you saw was one of Canada's submarines firing a torpedo for the very first time and sinking a ship. You can rest assured there was nobody on board the ship at the time, so you know nobody was injured or anything like that, but it was a big deal for the Canadian Navy to see her submarines operational for the first time. My intention today is to go back to the future. So we're going to start, that video was the present, slightly in the past, but we're going to talk about the future and work our way back through history. Now I understand this is my clicker here, so let's see if we can make it work. Perfect. So I'm never much for overview slides, so I'm just going to skip it. But when we look to the future, a lot of you might have heard that the Canadian Navy is in the process of participating in the National Shipbuilding Program. Two of the ships that are underway right now are the Harry DeWolf class, which we will talk quite a bit about today, and then the Queenston class auxiliary vessels, which will be built in Vancouver, BC, starting in 2017. When you look at the Harry DeWolf class, what that is an Arctic offshore patrol ship. So with the advent of this ship, Canada ceases to be a Northern Navy and starts to become an Arctic Navy. So for the students here, you might have heard of the Northwest Passage. That's the passage in the Arctic where ships can now transit through. It is not a future tense that I'm saying. Ships are transiting through that passage through the spring, summer, and fall months. So we need to have a presence there. And when we started building ships, they looked for someone to name the ship after. So who they chose to name it after was this gentleman here, Vice Admiral Harry DeWolf. Now, Admiral DeWolf, if you've heard of people like Nimitz and Nelson and Rader and Yamamoto, these are very famous admirals of other countries, Harry DeWolf is ours. So Harry, we could list off all the cool stuff he did there, but sometimes it's best to share a story or two to really paint a picture of the man. And you know, to start with, he participated in the sinking of 14 enemy ships. To sink one is a big deal, and you're a hero in the Navy as a captain of a ship when you get one. But this gentleman got 14 under his belt during conflict. He was the commanding officer of two aircraft carriers, which getting one appointment to an aircraft carrier is a big deal. Two is unheard of. But when he was at sea as a junior officer on the HMCS St. Laurent, one of the bosuns, which is a working sailor, you know, drives the boat, shoots the guns, was painting the torpedoes. And he thought, well, I want to do a really good job. So he lifted up the arming mechanism on the torpedo and painted that. And then he saw the launch plunger was a little rusty. So he started painting that and he accidentally hit it and the torpedo went off and started bouncing around the upper decks of the St. Laurent. So you can imagine, as you saw there, ships don't like torpedoes when they hit them. So the Harry was there and he saw the bosun trying to calm the torpedo, which you can't because it weighs hundreds and hundreds of pounds. So Harry jumped on board the torpedo and rode it like a bull around the deck of the ship while it was bouncing off bulkheads and the propeller was, you know, clanging off the iron deck of the ship. And while he struggled with it for some time, he said, I figured we were all going to go up anyway, so I might as well try. He managed to get to the air plunger and release all of the compressed air that drove the torpedo, discharged all the compressed air of the torpedo, settled the torpedo down, and basically was riding a torpedo that would have been his own death for sure. But that was just an indication of the kind of courage. This courage is a word I guess you could use to describe that. I don't know if it's the right word or not, but certainly it made him a little bit notorious amongst the fleet when he was a junior lieutenant. So we're naming a ship after him, and this will be the ship. I don't know that I'll get to sail in them, but my junior officers certainly will, and so will my junior sailors. A very capable ship. I'm not here to sell ships, but the interesting thing to me is that these ships will be on station in the Arctic for up to 6 months at a time. So very, very capable ship, and they're building these now. So in Halifax, If you get out there, you'll see Irving Shipyards right down by the water by, it's the McDonald Bridge, I think. And in there, they're already welding sections of these things together. So it's not raw steel anymore. We're getting something that looks like a ship coming forward very, very soon. You have to excuse my speaker notes here. It's the first time I've given this presentation, so it's a little bit new to me. Now, HMCS Margaret Brooks. So Dr. Brooke, she's very an impressive young woman at the time. She's still alive, which is lovely, because she got to find out that they're naming a ship after her while she's still with us. Now, what was interesting is when she was sailing off the coast of Nova Scotia, her ferry, the SS Caribou, was torpedoed by the Germans. And again, torpedoes seem to come into the conversation a lot, but when a torpedo hits a ship, the ship doesn't survive. There's no damage control. It doesn't matter how big you are, the ship is gonna sink. So she was asleep in her rack, was jolted awake by, you know, the impact of the torpedo. Water starts coming in like crazy. She got to the upper deck with her friend and saw that her lifeboat had been completely destroyed. So not knowing what to do, if you want to survive in the water, the best thing to do is stay out of the water. So they stayed on the ship and waited for it to sink. And then they found themselves in the water, and sometime later, a life raft that was capsized came by, and they climbed up onto the side of it, and she held on to her friend for hours and hours because her friend was unconscious and couldn't support herself anymore. And she said, sadly, I wasn't able to save her, but she did save, you know, numerous other people during that particular engagement. So we will be celebrating the keeling of HMCS Margaret Brooke in the very, very near future. Now Max, he's a chief petty officer, like Chief Quirkish here. This guy, he should be in the movies. If he wasn't in the movies, he should be. What happened was they got into a gun battle with a German U-boat on HMCS Assiniboine, and Chief Bernays was in the engine room. Well, the engine room caught on fire, and short of a torpedo hitting your ship, an engine room fire is the worst possible thing a ship can encounter. When HMCS Protector, you might have read last year, fought a fire for 16 hours in the electrical room in the engine room. That was a very grave situation, but our sailors acquitted themselves very heroically. Max, Chief Petty Officer Bernay, the fire started to engulf the ship. And when his captain ordered him to leave the wheelhouse, he refused and he stayed with his captain and he manned both throttle telegraphs and the helm. So he's doing the job of three people plus his own job in the wheelhouse while the ship was engulfed in flames. And the Assiniboine was able to eventually ram the U-boat, and his captain was able to fight the ship successfully to victory. And Max received a notice and dispatches, but was never really heavily decorated for that. So he will be receiving a ship in his name very shortly as well, which is very well deserved. Now this guy, we were talking about movies. If he was going to be played in a movie, Samuel L. Jackson should play him, I think. That would be my vote. He was a member of the Shannon Brigade. So before there were Navy SEALs and before there was Joint Task Force 2, in 1857 there was something called HMS Shannon, and they had this brigade on board that would do raids ashore, a naval landing party, if you will. So William Hall was one of the two last survivors of this Shannon Brigade, because they would go ashore and raise hell wherever they went, destroying enemy targets in the Far East and participating in the fighting in the British India Rebellion in 1857. Between the last two of them, which was his Lieutenant Young, they were the last two survivors, and they were last seen firing a gun so close to the enemy embankments that they were taking fire themselves, and he stayed no less than 20 yards away, which is from me to the bulkhead, so you can imagine exchanging cannon fire with your enemy at that kind of distance. But he didn't leave and he stayed, and he was able to breach the wall, so the ship was able to capture the rebels' fortress there. And one side note here is one of Canada's recipients of the Victoria Cross. So for those of you that don't know, the Victoria Cross is the highest honor that you can achieve for bravery. It's awarded by the Queen, and it's very rarely given to people that are alive, because usually their acts of courage, they fall during that. So if you're interested in that kind of thing, Google the Victoria Cross and read some of the stories of what these people did, and the stuff you see in movies doesn't stand up to what actually was done in real life. Now this one's got a soft spot for me. I'm excited about the Frederic Rolette. And you may wonder why. The gentleman, Lieutenant Navy Frederic Rolette, he was a member of the Royal Navy, and he was a member of the Provincial Marine, which in Ontario, before Canada was formed, we had a Naval Reserve, or the beginnings of a Naval Reserve, like I belong to, but we called it the Provincial Marine. Basically, Royal Navy officers would train sailors in southwestern Ontario how to man Royal Navy ships and that sort of thing. But at the advent of the War of 1812, he got word that the Americans had declared a war on us, so he thought, well, I'm going to go down to Detroit and I'm going to steal a ship. So he went down to Detroit, he stole a ship. The Americans didn't even know they were at war in Detroit, so this British officer shows up, starts rigging the ship, and sails it out of the harbor, and next thing you know, he realized he had some of the American general's secret papers and plans on board. He also had all of the American band's instruments on board, and the ship's officers' wives were all on board, which he didn't realize until he had sailed the ship out of harbor. So the Americans didn't know they were at war, but we took one of their ships. We kept the ship, we kept the band equipment, we kept the plans, but we gave the whites back, the wives back. So I thought it was a good gentlemanly thing to do. He was known to capture many ships through the War of 1812, so he didn't stop there. He would go on raids and capture American ships throughout. He was a commanding officer of the HMS General Hunter, and later during the Battle of Lake Erie, he was the commanding officer of HMS Lady Prevost, which is the namesake ship that my ship was named for. So in fact, he was my ship's very first captain and my predecessor, and he will have a ship named after him very, very shortly, which we are very delighted to hear of. One thing you need to understand with the Battle of Lake Erie, because it's often overlooked because we didn't do so well there. We didn't have enough experienced officers and some things went wrong. I won't get into the tactics of it. But essentially, we had destroyed the American flagship. Oliver Hazard Perry, who was manning it, had to abandon his flagship, take his flag to another ship. But unfortunately, because some of our sailors were junior, two ships collided, their masts were intertwined, and those ships were taken out of action. So that's over 26 guns removed from the fight, and it swayed the fight almost instantly to the side of the Americans. Ashore at this time, the Americans were burning southwestern Ontario to the ground, is what we need to remember. So it started at York, which is now Toronto. They burned it to the ground. Then they started moving southwest, and they made it to a place called Newark, which is now called Niagara-on-the-Lake, and they burnt it to the ground. And then they kept coming further south, and they just burned everything to the ground. So what's really interesting about this point in history, 60% of the people that live in the area that we live in, southwestern Ontario, were former American citizens. So much of southwestern Ontario were Americans that had moved north to get land and so on, and there were loyalists and that sort of thing too. But most of them were Americans, so the American army thought they were just gonna win us over with their great charm and promise of freedom and so on. But when they started burning everything to the ground, we started to take on the characteristic of anything but American. So you'll sometimes hear Canadians define themselves as not American, and that stems from the War of 1812 when the Americans were here and they're burning everything to the ground. And if you go over to Snake Hill on Commissioner's Road, the Battle of the Thames River was partially fought there, and that's a war site. So, and everything there got burned to the ground. So when Frederic Rolette sailed his ship to engage the Americans and engage Oliver Hazard Perry out of Putnam Bay, there was a lot at stake. It wasn't just control of Lake Erie. He understood that the future of his future nation was at stake. So now we're warping ahead to current operations. So Op Carib, we send a lot of sailors to this. This is present day, so this is ongoing. There's about two deployments a year. It began in 2006. We participate with MCDVs, usually, which are our coastal defense vessels, primarily manned by Naval Reservists. We also deploy some of our destroyers as well. And in 2015, just this year so far, our ships have captured 800 kilograms of marijuana and nearly 9 metric tons of cocaine. And that's uncut cocaine. So when you start thinking of that in terms of how many police stops does there have to be to get 9,000 kilograms of cocaine after it's been cut, like how many stops would that be at STA or CCH or the different schoolyards around the city, right? A lot. So it would have kept the police very, very busy to try and achieve what we were able to achieve with some of our ships on the high seas here. When we look at op reassurance, so many of you know that Russia is flexing its muscles in the Ukraine and the Crimea, and now more recently in Syria, but this op reassurance is mostly to deal with reassuring our eastern allies and friends like the Ukraine and some of the other countries over there. So we have deployed several ships there. We've had sailors from Prevost participate in this as well, other naval reservists from around the country, but one of my sailors, leading seaman Vin, was on board a Canadian frigate in the Black Sea, and he was there when the Russian MiGs buzzed the bridge. And one thing that his words were that always strike me is, sir, there was no such thing as a drill or a practice exercise when we were there. When we were there, everything was real. If the alarm went, it was real. We didn't practice, we just did. And very, very telling. So if you ever read somewhere that the Russians deny they buzzed the Canadian warship and that kind of stuff, we've got witnesses here in London too. Moving on, you know, the next one with op reassurance, we're still doing it. One of my sailors, Lieutenant JP Barrett, is sailing on board the Winnipeg with Joint Warrior, and he was joined by the Prince of Wales for a little while, the future king. And he's also been participating in exercises all through the Mediterranean. And when I get emails or Facebook messages from him, he says, sir, I can't tell you what I'm doing, but it's really cool. So sometimes I get a little jealous of my own sailors. Many of you remember the Gulf War and Operation Friction. So Operation Friction occurred because we weren't ready. And I'm sure the Admiral wouldn't like me putting it in those words. But we found ourselves having to go to a modern theater with ships that were quite old. So within, how long was it, Chief? 90 days, something like that. We refitted three of our ships with very modern weapon systems and sensors and got them ready to go. These were Cold War era ships, essentially. You know, they were designed to find and hunt Russian submarines, but they were turned into ships that could survive in a modern theater. When we got Terra Nova over there in Athabasca, and along with our AOR, our oiler, they were three of over 60 ships that were in the Persian Gulf at the time, but we conducted a full one-third of the interdictions and boardings, even though we only had three of the total fleet that was there. Going back a little further in time, we're skipping through the Cold War and hunting Soviet ships. We became known as an anti-submarine fleet during that period, and we became very good at it. So hunting submarines really became a focus of ours, but as you'll see in the Battle of Atlantic, it comes to us very honestly. So when we look at Korea, this is often a forgotten war. You know, it was called a police action at the time. We sent three destroyers initially. You need to remember at the end of World War II, and I'll mention this later, we were the third largest navy in the world. But at the outset of the Korean War, we had nine destroyers. So we contracted just as quickly as we expanded. We sent three destroyers over to respond to the North Korean invasion of South Korea. And our destroyers were responsible for everything from escorting American and Canadian aircraft carriers to hunting submarines, because there was always a threat of submarine attack. And also, one of the big things we did, we became known as the train busters. So the destroyers would get in so close to shore that they could engage enemy, destroy enemy trains, because the terrain of Korea was such that train tracks had to follow the coastline predominantly. So we were able to shell these trains and destroy these trains, but we had to get very, very close to do it, which made the ships very, very vulnerable to you know, coastal batteries and coastal artillery regiments and that sort of thing. So many of our ships were attacked, and when we were trying to destroy these Korean trains, we became very good at it, and the Canadians became known as the train busters, or the train buster squadron when we were there. And truthfully, the reason we did it is because no one else really had the guts to get close enough. So the Americans talk a big talk sometimes, but when there's dirty work to be done, often the Canadian Navy is the one doing it. So, Battle of the Atlantic, and I'm going to spend the majority of my talk talking about this. And the reason I'm going to put so much focus onto the Battle of Atlantic is many of us don't realize that this battle was the longest fought battle in Canadian history. So I could ask you about Vimy. I'm sure you would have heard of Vimy. Every head would start nodding if I talked about Passchendaele or Ypres or Dieppe or Juneau or D-Day or the Italian campaign or even South Africa. Some of you'd know our involvement in the Crimea a long time ago. We would all be familiar with that. But one thing that's often overlooked, and to my chagrin, too often overlooked is the contribution of Canada to the Battle of the Atlantic. So what we need to understand is the Battle of Atlantic was not a quick battle where it was a surface engagement between ships that, you know, met in the night and started shooting each other. This was a battle that was fought over numerous years. From 1939 to 1945, Canada kept the sea lanes between North America and England and certainly Russia open. This was no small part to due to remarkable effort on part of the entire country, which is also unique to this battle because every port along the Great Lakes was building ships at that time, whether they were small corvettes or tenders or minesweepers or destroyers. The shipbuilding industry wasn't just Halifax and Vancouver, Victoria. It was the entirety of the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence Seaway. When we started the Battle of the Atlantic, we had 6 ocean-going ships and 3,500 personnel. 6 years later, at the end of it, we were the third largest Navy. We had over 110,000 people. So we went from 3,500 to 110,000 people in 6 years, trained sailors. It's sometimes hard for me to give you an explanation of what it takes to train a sailor up that quickly, but to train that many in of itself is remarkable. We also went from 6 ships to over 350 ocean-going ships. Now, not all of them were big modern destroyers like you might think of today. Most of them were minesweepers and corvettes. We became known as a corvette navy. The corvettes, we'll talk a little bit about them in a moment. But the other thing that happened that's often overlooked in the Battle of the Atlantic was at the outset of war with Germany, there were thousands of ships transiting the high seas at any one time. And it fell to Canada to take control instantaneously of all of the shipping on the Atlantic Ocean. So our naval control of shipping officers suddenly found themselves with the responsibility of thousands of ships to control and direct where they should go and forming them into convoys. That happened again in 2001 on September 11th when a Canadian naval control of shipping cells found themselves in the Pentagon on September 11th, and when the plane hit after they had diverted all of the aircraft to, you know, Gander, Newfoundland and other airports, it occurred to the Americans that we have all of these ships coming into our eastern seaboard and no way to control them. And so they looked across the table at the Canadian Naval Control of Shipping teams that were there, who then stood up and actually took control of all shipping for the American eastern seaboard for several days. And it's something, you know, Canadians, we tend to be too humble and too quiet about our achievements, but it was a remarkable effort on the part of our guys and ladies that did that. So what we see with this is because the shipbuilding was so fast, the ships that we built, corvettes were wet ships, meaning when you sailed on them, you were never dry. Even when you went below and you were sleeping in your hammock was wet, your clothes were wet, you were never dry. Went through the seams and through the funnels and through the air ducts, you were just constantly wet. You were also likely very cold. This is the North Atlantic, not the Mediterranean, not the South Pacific, where most of our allies fought. We were given the task of the harshest seas in the world and fighting a foe that was no you know, come by night organization. The German Kriegsmarine and their U-boat fleet were the finest submarine force to ever sail the seas. And it felt like little Canada with its 6 ships at the start to fight the German U-boats. At stake was the survival of Great Britain. One thing that we should recognize here was that without the Canadian effort of keeping the sea lines open and resupplying Great Britain, Germany would have had a much, much easier go of it, because there we'll come to a gentleman here named Admiral Dönitz in a second. But he was the mastermind behind the German wolf packs, and he understood that if they could starve England, England would fall. Now, it sounds like a bad thing, England falling, and it certainly would have been, but our Prime Minister at the time vowed that if England did fall, Canada would carry on the fight by itself. So when you think of that, France is gone, England is gone, Germany is allied with the Soviet Union at the time, the Americans haven't entered the war yet, and here's Canada saying, if there's no one left, it'll be us against them. And he meant it. So it was one reason why the Canadian Navy grew so rapidly, because there was so much at stake. It wasn't just the survival of Great Britain, but it was the survival of Western culture, essentially. So there was massive consequences to this fight here. One thing that happened because of the conditions of the sailors were in, and it was so harsh, is they started a bond, they started to form a very special bond between different messes. So the officers, the junior ranks, and the chief and petty officers found themselves creating a very special relationship that we still see carried on today, and that's somewhat foreign to other navies. When I dine with chiefs and petty officers, or if I can have a wet with one of my crew, you just wouldn't see American officers do that. And it comes from the tradition of the hardship that they had during this conflict. So in the early months of the war, basically it was Canadian destroyers were escorting convoys across the sea. Convoy wasn't a Canadian invention, but we were the ones that figured it out and mastered it. The Americans didn't think convoys were important, so they would sail their ships individually, and they were just ripe for the plucking. So the Germans were sinking, you need to understand, two ships for every ship we built. So we're sinking ships twice as fast as we could build them. And one thing that Winston Churchill once said is the best thing that could happen to the war effort is the American admiral in charge of the Eastern, in charge of the Atlantic war effort should just join the German Navy and get it over with, because he was so incompetent and wouldn't buy into the convoy concept here. So we saw our first action in 1939 against the Germans. Then we participated in the sinking of U-39 from HMS Salmon, which was a major victory and coup for us because we saw a U-boat sunk with Canadian sailors on a British ship, but that U-boat had just finished sinking four of our merchant marine ships. So as we mentioned earlier, the Navy was expanding at an incredible pace. In 1940, we ordered 92 small warships consisting of 64 corvettes and 28 minesweepers, and there was a standing order for destroyers to build them as fast as you can. So today, when the government orders 10 to 12 new warships, you know, and it's a big deal, and we're building five new Arctic patrol vessels and two oiler tankers, and we think, okay, we're building 20 ships, that's a massive shipbuilding program. In World War II, we were building 92 at a time. So really, really remarkable. With the corvettes, again, let me just be blunt with this, they sucked. You know, they weren't pleasant to sail on, but they were fast, they were maneuverable, and they were able to take the fight to the enemy. Often these guys would run out of ammunition, their hedgehogs and torpedoes and depth charges, and they'd find themselves ramming German submarines if they needed to. Now the Merchant Navy demands respect. So even being, you know, a warfighting by trade sailor, you just can't give enough credit to the gentlemen that sailed on these ships. What you need to remember is their ships were often very old. They'd be loaded with fuel and ammunition, so they're floating bombs essentially, and they would sail across the ship trusting that the escorts that they had with them were going to protect them from the German U-boats. Thousands of these ships were lost, and the men with them numbered in the tens of thousands. So, but they sailed with the intent and the knowledge of that freedom itself was at stake. So when you see a veteran, you know, at a cenotaph or a memorial, and he doesn't have any of the war fighting medals, but he's standing there in a naval uniform, he may very well have been a merchant mariner, and he certainly deserves as much respect as his counterparts to his left and to his right. Without these ships, there would have been no war left to fight. So the Atlantic supply route, we're not just talking about going from Halifax over to Londonbury or to different parts of England. We were in charge of something called the Murmansk runs, where we supplied the Soviet Union through northern Arctic channels. We had the hardest job of all the navies. What we need to understand is the British were engaged all over the world fighting the fight. The Americans for the first 2 years weren't even in World War II. So it was left to us to handle the North Atlantic and the U-boats of the North Atlantic. The Brits were often in the Mediterranean. If you ever go to the Mediterranean, you quickly realize why they prefer it there over the North Atlantic. And the Americans like the South Pacific, and here we are in the Atlantic. So we did such an admirable job with this that the British Admiralty in 1943 strongly considered turning over the entire control of the entire Atlantic Ocean to the Canadian Navy. Now, that might not sound like a lot, but when you realize this is the Royal Navy we're talking about. So, you know, the most proud and historic fleet that had ever sailed the seas are saying to us, we'd like you to handle the Atlantic Ocean. Now, they out of sources of pride and control and the recognition that their country's life was at stake, they certainly stayed involved. But we were nearly given the whole show. We don't often talk about our opponents, but Karl Dönitz was the mastermind behind the German U-boat fleet. He came up with the concept of the wolf packs, where seven or eight or more German submarines would sail together and attack convoys at night. The effects were devastating. They would sink tens of thousands of tons every day. 2,900 ships were lost during the six-year war. So think about that 2,900. That's nearly a ship every day during the course of the war. 14 million tons of Allied shipping. So it simply could not be replaced as fast as it was being destroyed. So something had to be done. Fortunately, Hitler and his bosses didn't agree with them. So Dönitz thought we can win the war through submarines, but Hitler and the rest of his staff thought that no, we need surface ships. And so they started built ships like Bismarck, Tirpitz, Graf Spee, and other famous German ships that really had a very minimal effect on the war. And really, it came down to these German U-boats that Canada was engaged with. So you can see the damage of one torpedo there. That's a ship that got lucky, because you can take a picture of it after the torpedo impacted. But by the end of the war, we were conducting almost all of the convoys across the ocean, and it took the Americans until nearly 1945 before they recognized they should participate in the Canadian convoy routes. In 1942, though, Dönitz recognized, well, we're not going to beat them on the high seas. So let's attack them close to shore, particularly the Americans, because they weren't protecting their shipping. So our fleet was somewhat recalled, but we had very few ships to spare. They were so busy. But we were seeing U-boats shooting torpedoes in the St. Lawrence Seaway. And one ship that was sunk, HMCS Windflower, was sunk in the St. Lawrence on December 7th, 1941, which is the same day as Pearl Harbor. So there are instances of World War II coming to Canada, and it might be hard to see, but where there's black dots along the Atlantic coastline of Canada, that is where merchant ships were lost because of German submarines. So this, when we say it was a world war, it was a true world war. You can see in South America, you can see in Africa, you can see in the Caribbean around Cuba, there's shipping being sunk all over. Now, this would have never happened. We would never have been able to participate in this action if the Canadian Navy had never stood up. So the origins of our Navy are very humble. Beginning in 1910, Sir Wilfrid Laurier introduced the Naval Service Bill, which really put the Canadian Navy into existence. Prior to that, we just looked at sending money over to Britain because it was deemed too expensive to have a Navy, and did we really need a Navy after all? Well, after some debate in Parliament, it was recognized that Canada was a maritime nation. And they might not have understood that we had the second largest coastline in the world at the time, and they may not have understood the full significance of how much trade is sent across the oceans in 1910, but they understood that Canada, if it was going to be taken seriously as a proper nation, had to have a proper naval service. So the Canadian Navy was stood up, started with just one ship, HMCS Rainbow, and then eventually grew to the six destroyer squadron that we had at the beginning, the outbreak of World War II. I'm going to try to close with this. So when we start looking at the Navy and how it affects London, HMCS Prevost, being my ship, was formed during World War II, and we put together over 4,400 officers, close to 4,500 officers and men to sail in the Canadian Navy. And those officers and men, for the high school students that are here, were your age. So these weren't people in their 20s, 30s, and 40s, although there were some. Most of them would be 17, 18, 19, 20 at the outside. And they were recruited at the Prevost, which was down on Old Carling Street, and for a while it was on Richmond Street. It was named, as we mentioned, after the Lady Prevost, which fought during the War of 1812. But typically what we find now, we are primarily a force generator. So my job is to train sailors so that they can go to places like the Middle East, or they can go to places like the Ukraine, or they can sail on the ships as they transit around the world. But one thing we always do try to remember, and what we'll be remembering tomorrow, is the sacrifices of the men who have been lost at sea over the years. Also the sacrifices of their families, their wives, their children, and so on. So when you're going to a cenotaph, or you're remembering the contributions of our soldiers, sailors, and airmen, the one thing I would do is encourage you not to go into a state of mourning. Tomorrow is not mourning day. Tomorrow is not sadness day. Tomorrow is remembrance day. What we can be very proud of as Canadians is to know that the battles we fought, we won. So it was through the sacrifice of these courageous people that we enjoy our freedoms today. So when you see the old timers out there in their Legion uniforms and their medals, and I mean they'll have racks of medals like the gentleman you can see on the right there, they should be congratulated for their heroism and thanked for their service. But certainly the last thing they want is to be mourned or feel sorry for, because sorry, that is the other side of pity, and that is not what they want. If you were to ask a member of the Royal Canadian Regiment, one of their colonels who was visiting his wounded from Afghanistan, he asked some of his corporals and privates that were lying in the hospital, you know, why did you do it? Would you do it again? And they would echo their regimental motto of Pour Patria, which is for country. So they did it for us, they did it for you. And please remember and celebrate their victories tomorrow. Don't feel a sense of sadness for them. There was no lives sacrificed unnecessarily. These gentlemen knew that they had lived to meet their destiny, so they lived a life where they knew that their job on this earth had been fulfilled when they met their maker. They had no second thoughts about that. So one thing we're doing at Prevost is trying to remember some of the sailors. And one thing that makes a sailor unique is we don't get gravestones. When we die in action, we go to the bottom of the sea, and there's no marker, there's nothing on the high seas, there's no flowers laid, there's no, you know, granite tombstone to mark where a ship went down. So at Prevost here in London, Ontario, we've erected something called the Naval Memorial Park, and the largest portion of that is this, which is the Battle of Atlantic Memorial. On our hillside, which you're very, very welcome to go and see, although there's some construction happening right now, you can see the stones. Each stone marks a ship lost, a Canadian ship lost during the Battle of Atlantic. There's 24 for the Royal Canadian Navy and one for the Merchant Marine. On Battle of Atlantic Sunday, and also during Remembrance Day, we put a poppy out front for every sailor lost on each ship. Then we have a memorial, a remembrance project? And we're finding the pictures of every sailor from every ship, and we're putting them in frames. So you can see the young lads that sailed on these ships, and you can see their faces. One that was very, you know, I'll close with a couple of little stories here about this. We did this as part of our 2010 centennial celebration. So in Canada, our Navy turned 100 years old. Each Naval Reserve Division was said, find a way to, you know, mark the Navy service. So one of our officers took this in hand and raised the money to have this constructed. We didn't really know what we were getting into when we did this. We just thought this will be nice, you know, and a nice piece of remembrance. What started to happen is people came from all over Canada to see it. And a lot of veterans started to show up because they had sailed on these ships but didn't sail the day when they were torpedoed or sunk. So one of the old timers that I'll never forget was in Halifax. He was supposed to sail on his ship, but he had to have some dental work done, so he had to stay ashore. And while he was getting his teeth fixed, the ship sailed. It was sunk and torpedoed by a German U-boat in the Atlantic on the way to St. John's, Newfoundland. He flew to St. John's and he was waiting for his ship, only to find out his ship had been sunk on the way over. And he'd felt the weight of that his entire life. So now he shows up at Prevost at 80, 85 years young, and he wants to climb up to the, you can see the one that's highest on the hill, that was his ship. And he wanted to climb up to that to get there. So of course we offered to help him. He's 85 years old. He would have none of it. He pushed us away and he crawled up there on his hands and knees to get there to put a poppy down to mark for his friends. When we dedicated this memorial, the commanding officer of the Louisburg, who is in the center of the hill, when his ship was torpedoed, he refused to leave. And you always hear the captain goes down with his ship, and fortunately for me, it's a rumor, it doesn't have to happen. but hopefully my ship never goes down. But the captain of the Louisburg was being evacuated by his coxswain, and his coxswain was trying to get his captain safely to his lifeboat, but his captain would have none of it. And he pushed his coxswain away, and he went to the engine room door, which was sealed shut from the ship getting twisted by the torpedo impact. And he could hear the calls of his boys in the engine room. Excuse me. And he stayed with them, you know, while the ship sank. One of my friends was a commanding officer of one of the MCDVs, and he came to dedicate the memorial that day, and it was his grandfather. So it just shows to me, you know, the Navy, we have a real sense of family, and to see the gentleman's grandson there to dedicate the stone in the memory of his grandfather's ship was really telling. And these are just two stories I could share with you, many, many stories we could. But what we're doing, and I have a little bit of an agenda here. If you'd like to help us, I have some pamphlets here. We need to, the veterans are trying to build a walkway in front of it so some of the vets can get there safely in their wheelchairs and walkers. And if you have any ability to help us, whether you have expertise in fundraising or construction or something like that, certainly it's not becoming a naval officer to ask for money. That's not why I'm here. But if you could help us with some time or talent, we'd be very, very grateful. I'm sure they wouldn't turn your money away either, but I'm not going to be asking for it. So we do have some pamphlets there. So whenever you have the opportunity to remember the services of your Canadian Armed Forces, whether they are the Army, the Air Force, or the Royal Canadian Navy, I would encourage you to make a trip to our Battle of Atlantic Memorial right at the fork of the Thames. So you're welcome to come over. If the gates close, just go to the building and ring the bell, and we'll certainly have someone come out and give you the grand tour. For your students, what I would encourage you to do is ask your teachers to take you on a field trip in the spring to come and see it. You can just call the ship, and we'll arrange that for you and make sure you have tour guides, and we'll walk you through each of the memorials there. It'd be a good day out for you. With that, I hope I haven't gone too long here, but I'd like to thank you for your attention. I'd also like to invite you all to the Cenotaph tomorrow to remember all of the Canadians that have served our great country over its nearly 150 years of existence. Thank you very much.